Let's go to Los Angeles, where Howie Klein is standing by. He is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC. They raise money for progressive and sometimes socialist candidates. Read him every day over at Down with Tyranny. Thank you, Mr. Klein. Let's start with the latest Real Clear politics poll averages, because it's not being reported. Okay?
Oh, what? I didn't look at it today, but let me just guess what you're going to say. Bernie went up.
Yes.
Yes. Yes. He's now number two?
Yep. Across the board.
I knew it. Without looking, I knew it.
Yeah. Nationally, he's number two. In Iowa, he's number two. New Hampshire, he's number two. In Nevada, he's tied at number two with Warren. What
in is some of these polls, he's number one. You know, sometimes you get a poll where he'll be number one in New Hampshire, number one in Nevada. You see him number one over and over. In the latest California poll that I saw, he was tied for number one in California, which is a very big deal.
What does your instinct tell you
about
his chances of getting the nomination right now? Because we're 2 months away from Iowa, right?
Right. We are. I don't know that Iowa has that much. You know, at one time, Iowa was more important than it is now. I don't know how much impact Iowa is going to have. But it'd be nice to do, you know, to walk out of Iowa with a whole pack of delegates. Mm-hmm. I think Iowa will be a better thing to winnow the field a little bit more. So I think, you know, someone like Kamala Harris, that's her last stand.
Right.
She'll go into Iowa. And she's not the only one. I'm just bringing her up because she's already, you know, basically cut back her staff in her headquarters in Baltimore, and she's closed her offices down in New Hampshire. And that's what a candidate does when they're about to throw in the towel, which she, I believe, is about to do.
Yes.
So Iowa will be a place where people will, you know, see they have no support, and they'll just leave the race. Surprisingly, this week we had two people already do that. You know, although a lot of people didn't even know either one of them was running, the governor of Montana, Steve Bullock, pulled out this morning, and the day before that, Joe Sestak, former congressman, former admiral, who's a good guy, and he pulled out as well.
Okay.
So two less candidates, but not candidates that have been on the debate stage.
Will we see a debate before New Hampshire where it's Bernie versus Biden, where they can really go toe-to-toe?
Just the two of them?
Well, but will there be something similar to Tulsi versus Mayo that we saw last month?
Oh, I don't know. I don't know. I mean, you know, Bernie doesn't want to fight with other candidates. Bernie just wants to put his message out to the American people. If you've noticed, Bernie has a tendency to try in a polite way to ignore the moderators and their stupid questions, and he just wants to tell voters what he wants to do. And if he could fit that into the context of one of their questions, he does. And if he can't, then he ignores the question and does it anyway.
Okay. I've asked you this before, and I have Professor Harvey J.K. on the show tonight.
Oh, he's great.
He's great.
Yeah.
Yeah. And I asked him this question, and I've asked you this before. What mistake is Bernie making? I cannot think of a single mistake that Bernie has made this time around.
I don't want to talk about that, because I do know some mistakes that are being made, and they, you know, they don't like hearing it. And, you know, what if they hear this?
Oh, OK. All right.
Good. I will tell you. I think that the you know, last time around, his media, his email campaign was really, really good. And this time, I don't think it's good. And I, you know, I feel bad to say that, because he's probably, you know, someone is taking care to hire someone that they think is good and that they like. But I just think that I get their emails, and they're just not good.
Well, he's asking for money all the time. Everything's an ask.
Yeah, and I don't mind that. And some of the emails are pretty good, but some of them aren't, and it's too much. And, you know, I get like one constantly, you know, referencing how much I've given them and asking me to give that amount again. And that's odd. And I can see doing it once or twice, but they're not doing it once or twice. They're doing it, you know, I'm getting that email a few times a week, that same basic email. So I don't think that, I don't know, I don't think the strategy is good. I think last time it was, like, great, and it's what everybody should be doing, what they did last year, but they should be doing what they did last year themselves this year. But, you know, on the other hand, they're raking in a lot of money, so I think that the person who's doing their email or the company that's doing their email is probably taking credit for, look how brilliant we are, we're making more money than anybody, we're raking in more money than anybody. But I just feel that it's hurting Bernie's brand. It's my opinion, and I don't think anyone cares that I have that opinion.
Well, over at Down with Tyranny, you have a chart about media spending, which I thought was really interesting. Bernie is not spending as much, obviously, as Bloomberg. I think Elizabeth Warren is spending more. Donald Trump is spending more. He is not.
I think AOP is spending more.
Yeah.
Iyer is spending more than anybody.
Right. Yes. And that's not working for Steyer. So when...
Well, remember, these people have to catch up with Bernie in terms of, not Trump, but the others have to catch up with Bernie in terms of name recognition. And that's really, it's horrible to say that that's our democracy, but that's the single biggest factor in people's voting is name recognition. And they're at a point now, you know, people, you know, we know who Tom Steyer is, but most people have never heard his name. They have no idea. When I go through some of the polling, and I mean, believe it or not, it's a very, very tiny percentage, but there is a percentage of Americans who say they've never heard of Donald Trump. I know it seems insane, right? It just seems crazy. But and I'm thinking, are they joking? Do they tell the pollsters this to be funny, or are they really that stupid? And I don't know the answer, but it's what comes out in every poll. They'll always that ask this question. There will always be people who don't know Trump, and you know more who don't know Pence. And you know certainly when you start going into, you know, do you have a favorable or unfavorable outlook on Nancy Pelosi or on Mitch McConnell, you wouldn't believe the number of people who say they don't know who they are, they've never heard of them, or they don't know enough about them to have an opinion. Huge numbers.
Okay.
So, you know, more people have heard of Bernie than the other candidates, especially when you start getting down to people, you know, like Steyer, people don't know who he is. Mayo Pete, they don't know who he is. Even Bloomberg, they don't know who he is. So, you know,
they themselves don't know who they are.
Well, they don't know what their policies are.
Yeah.
But, you know, it's interesting that Bloomberg is not going to debate. He thinks he's going to, you know, win this thing without getting on the debate stage. And he thinks he can just do it by spending a lot of money. I mean, and this isn't my opinion. This is what his own advisors are telling him and telling us about his campaign.
By the way,
and, you know, maybe I don't think it's possible, but who knows? I noticed today in a serious poll that he jumped over Kamala Harris in terms of not in terms of favorability, but in terms of the ultimate favorability. Who do you want to vote for?
Right.
So he was at, I believe, at 6%. Yes, he was at 6%, and she was at 2%.
Okay. I want to thank you because I went to a couple of parties this past weekend and I quoted you about Mayor Bloomberg's ad buys and everybody was very impressed. I said, well, you know, Howie Klein told me that maybe the reason he's running is he's just trying to get a discount on ad buys to trash Donald Trump. And that's one of the benefits
really,
to listen to the show. Yeah. You don't think that's the case.
But his people are saying to get you know, people like me to stop beating up on him, but it's not working and they're not saying it anymore. I mean, he's just, you know, he is being attacked ruthlessly from the left.
Okay.
And he doesn't care. But speaking of that, I know it's someone who you like a lot, but Willie Brown did an op-ed in the San Francisco Chronicle this week. Where he is very, very favorable to Bloomberg. Bloomberg must have given him money at some point. And he says, you know, all the Bernies in the world aren't going to be able to stop him because he'll just spend and spend and spend. You know, I think that he used a quote like he has not yet begun to spend.
Yeah. I wanted to ask you about Willie Brown, and you wrote about Willie's piece. You wrote about his piece over at Down with Tyranny, and you compared it to Ross Douthat's piece in the New York Times.
In the New York, yeah. And the thing is that, you know, Ross is an in-house conservative at the Times, and he wrote a very favorable piece about Bernie, whereas Willie Brown used to be a liberal a long, long time ago, and he, you know, he's, you know, made it clear that he's, you know, a corporate shill. And he thinks that, you know, I think if he had his choice, the nominee would be Bloomberg.
Yeah.
Which is interesting because he, of course, is the person who got Kamala Harris started in politics. Mm-hmm. He was both her boyfriend and her mentor. And, you know, I think he's, you know, I mean, they obviously broke up long ago.
Right.
But I don't think he's impressed with her.
Right. Let's get the Ross Douthat article out of the way. Then I want to talk to you about Willie Brown and how one can become conflicted in politics, because I have a history with Willie Brown that I think probably most people from the Bay Area do. But I'll get to him in a second. Ross Douthat.
I lived there when he was at his height of power.
Yeah.
You know, it's a long, long time ago. People change.
Right.
And, you know, he's a, you know, an old man now, and, you know, he was fighting a different battle at the time than he's, you know, now he's probably fighting to not pee in his pants.
Right. Well, let's get back to Willie in a second, because Ross Douthat said something at the end of that piece that I thought was really great. And he said that if Bernie shies away from identity politics and just focuses on economic issues, he could court a lot of Trump voters. A lot of Republicans will come to him as long as he stays as an economic populist. Do you agree with that?
Yeah. I, you know what? That wasn't my favorite part of the column, because Republicans, you don't need Republicans to be Trump. You know, yes, Bernie would get, you know, would win a few states with them, and that's a big deal. But right now, Bernie has to consider winning. He has to talk about and plan about winning the primary. So that mm-hmm. so that takes after voters, most of them anyway.
Right.
But you know, Bernie made very, very clear when the DNC announced very early in the campaign season that they were writing off certain states. They specifically talked about Ohio, that they were writing. You know, Bernie was the next day did an interview where he made fun of them and said, well, you know, they can do whatever they want. We're already working in Ohio. Mm-hmm. I mean, Bernie has every intention in the world of winning Ohio. And, okay, you know, that means that he will probably have to pursue some Trump voters, not Republicans necessarily, but Democrats that were disenchanted with Hillary, mm-hmm. which is different. Yes, they were Trump voters, but they're not Republicans.
Right.
And Bernie has every intention of getting those people back in states like, you know, certainly all through the Midwest. That's where Bernie is going to win those people, in Michigan, in Indiana, even Ohio, Wisconsin, Iowa. You know, Bernie is going to triumph in those states. I did two pieces in a row yesterday about Kentucky. You know,
The Trillbillies.
Well, the Trillbillies are in this county in Kentucky called Letcher County or Letcher County. And the numbers were very interesting. I mean, Trump, I don't remember the exact numbers, but Trump beat Hillary there something like 80-20. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's how badly she did. Primary day, Bernie got more votes in that county, not just more votes than Hillary. He got more votes than Hillary, Trump, Cruz, Kasich, Rubio, and he got more, let's put it like this, he got more votes than all of them combined. He got more votes than everyone else who is running as a Democrat and a Republican combined.
Amazing.
The people in that county who voted 80% for Trump in the general, they knew what change, they want change in their lives. Their lives are miserable. They don't want the same thing. Hillary represented the status quo. So they decided to take a gamble and go with Trump. They're not going to do that again. They know what, you know, the change that Trump brought for these kind of people was bad.
Mm-hmm.
And that's why I think Bernie can do well. I'm not predicting that he's going to win in Kentucky, but I'll tell you something. The guy who just won the governorship against Trump's candidate. I mean, Trump went to Kentucky and made the whole race about himself, literally. I mean, his last speech the night before the election in
Kentucky.
I'm trying to remember the name of the city. Lexington. He was in Lexington, Kentucky, and he made a speech where he literally said he started. Him and his stand-up comedy.
Mm-hmm.
He started talking to Bevin, the current governor and his closest ally, and he says to him, "You can't lose this." And then he turns to the audience and says, "This is, don't do this to me. It's going to be embarrassing for me if you do this."
Right.
So, you know, he definitely went to every state that he campaigned in. He made it about him. This is about me. He just says it. I mean, this is why Boris Johnson is freaking out right now. Trump is going over there, and he's afraid that Trump is going to start saying nice things about him, and the British hate Trump, and he's afraid to be identified with Trump.
Right.
But and told Trump to please don't do it. But that doesn't mean Trump isn't going to do it. But in any case, back to Kentucky, Trump made it very clear that this was an election about him. Now, the guy who won, Andy Beshear. This is what happened with Andy. He beat Hillary in the only two counties in the state that she won. So she won Jefferson County, which is Louisville, and she won the county that's got Lexington. So she won those two counties. Beshear beat her in both of them. Very, very much beat her.
Right. 3 years later.
Right. 3 years later, Beshear beat her, had better numbers than her in every county in the state. So although she lost every other county, he won some of them. He won counties that are coal mining counties. He won counties that are completely Republican. I brought up one, which is the county that Rand Paul, the other senator, is in. I wish I could remember what the county was, but it's a county in the western part of the state, very, very Republican county, and Beshear beat him, beat Bevin in that county. He won Republican counties all over the state. He didn't win a majority of them, but he won enough so that he is now the governor-elect of that state. And he beat Hillary's numbers in all of them. He beat Hillary's numbers in the county she won, and he beat Hillary's numbers in the county she lost. So that, and he, unlike the guy in Mississippi, Beshear ran as a Democrat. The guy in Mississippi who lost, by the way, ran as a Republican-like candidate. Real Democrats look at a guy like the guy that they had running in Mississippi, and they say, why, you know, yeah, he's better than the Republican, but not that much better. And why bother to even go out to the polls and vote for him?
So what does this say for Mitch McConnell, who's running for re-election in Kentucky in 2020?
Very, very, very tough to figure this one out. Every year, the Democrats get their hopes up because Mitch McConnell is the most unpopular senator in the country. That doesn't mean he's unpopular with people in California and New York. It means he's unpopular with people in Kentucky. More unpopular with people in Kentucky than anyone is in their own state. That's what that statistic is about. So it's reason to be hopeful. But he wins anyway every time. I don't know. I don't think the Democrats are going to be able to beat him. That's okay. My thought. I wish they could, but it's going to take a gigantic tsunami to beat him of such magnitude that the Democrats are just going to, you know, just sweep the Senate. It's going to not. I think the Democrats are going to win the Senate, but to get Mitch McConnell out of there, and the Democrats don't really have a strong candidate. Very, very tough. The guy who I thought could do it, this guy Jones, the sportscaster, he says he's not running.
Let me ask you a structural question about the Democratic campaign. So this new Harris poll came out. I think you referenced it. And I'm shocked by this because I think it bodes well. So it's the national poll, 2020 Democratic preference, 31% for Joe Biden.
And a little up. He went a little up in that poll, unfortunately.
Right. And Bernie Sanders is in second place.
But he went a little down.
Yes. And so he's got 15%. So Joe Biden has twice as much as Bernie. But then Elizabeth Warren went down even further, 10%. Buttigieg, 9%. Bloomberg opens with 6%. Here's my structural question to you, because I'm curious about Biden's staying power. Can you... Are these winner-take-all primaries, or does it...
Mostly not. No, they're not. The Democrats do not have winner-take-all primaries.
So
everybody gets some delegates.
So it is conceivable that going into Super Tuesday or past Super Tuesday, that Biden could be in the lead, but Bernie could be scooping up delegates coming in second place, right?
Oh, yeah.
Interesting.
But I don't even think that that's what's going to happen. I still stick by what I've been saying all along, that Biden is not going to be the winner of this thing. He's going to continue going down. That Harris poll, by the way, I mean, it's nice that Bernie is doing well in it, but the Harris poll is a lagging indicator. It's not really a good poll.
All right, let me challenge you and myself on this, because you've been right about everything. You said that Buttigieg would sink, and he, except in Iowa, he is. You said Kamala Harris.
And in Iowa, you have to remember something. I know I've said this before. Iowa is not a primary. It's a caucus. That means you go in with your neighbors, you sit down, and you talk. So the fact, what's important is in Iowa isn't always who you favor when you walk in, it's how much you favor them. And all of the polls that I've seen, and it's very hard to poll a caucus, Iowa polling is never accurate. And what's important is to know how committed you are to your candidate. And constantly, every poll shows the same thing. Bernie's delegates they ain't going nowhere. They're with Bernie, and they're not moving. No one's going to be able to move them. They are with Bernie, period, end of story. Buttigieg, he doesn't have anyone who feels that way. He could wind up with nothing. Nobody cares about him. Mm-hmm. You know, the young gay guy, sure.
Right.
But they don't really care. The people who say they're for him are for him, but they're very amenable to being talked out of him. Biden, not as much, but Biden doesn't have a strong following like that either. The two candidates that people are wedded to are Bernie and Elizabeth Warren. Those are the two. The rest of them, their followers are going to be talked out of it by the end of the caucus. That's why people are going to be shocked after the Iowa caucus. Like, wow, what happened to Pete Buttigieg? Nothing. He didn't get any votes.
Okay, listen, you've been right all along, but let me ask you to do a gut check here. How much of it is wishful thinking about Joe Biden? Because I'm looking at, I understand the argument, and I believe this, why he's going to, I don't think he's going to make it. As you said, I think his head is going to fall off.
We'll show him going down.
Yes.
There'll always be one, you know, that shows him going up, like the Harris poll, although he only went up by one point. But most of the polls show him going down. So that's the value of Real Clear Politics, is they show an average of the polls.
Right.
That doesn't even mean that that's right. But at least it's better than just one single poll where you get, you know, all these bizarre cases that just don't make any sense. So polling is a lot tougher than it looks.
Yeah.
And you know that because three polls will come out on the same day and they'll all be completely different.
Right. So he is in fourth place in Iowa right now, and he's in fourth place in New Hampshire. Talking about Biden, he's in first place in Nevada.
Yeah, and if that happens, those are the first two contests. And if he winds up coming in really, really badly, the theory at least is that voters in other states will be influenced away from him because nobody wants to back a loser.
But South Carolina comes next, and that changes everything, doesn't it?
Not really. Not really. South Carolina is a very, very specific vote. And I don't know that it's going to change much, to tell you the truth. And people know that it's a Republican state, and it doesn't really matter that much. And no one is going to contest South Carolina anyway,
okay,
in the general. And the thing is that by the time South Carolina comes around, half the people in California are filling out their absentee ballots. Mm-hmm. And that's going to matter a lot more because California has more delegates than all those other states combined.
Okay.
And that's what's important. And I think there are voters in California that if they see that Biden can't make it in Iowa and can't make it in New Hampshire, they're filling out their ballots already. They're going to say, well, you know, maybe Bernie is the one that can beat Trump.
Right. I'm utterly convinced that this is an analog to 1980, that Bernie is Reagan. You know, Reagan ran against Ford in 76, almost got the nomination. Bernie ran against Hillary, who was kind of like the incumbent in 2016, almost got the nomination. And nobody saw the subterranean undercurrents that brought the Reagan Revolution to the fore. And I think most people aren't seeing the revolution that Bernie is about.
Or if they see it, they're doing everything they can to stop it because they're scared of it, and they should be.
Yeah, and the same things people said about Reagan in 76 and 80 are the identical things that people are saying about Bernie, that his supporters are extremists, he can't win, he's dangerous, he's crazy, he'll destroy the country.
And he's old.
Yes, he'll be the oldest president ever elected. All that being said, if Biden gets the nomination, what do you think you would have not seen? Because I think you're seeing what's happening. But what are you not seeing with Biden?
That Democrats are stupid as Republicans?
That
I don't want to see that. I don't want to believe that.
Right, but that there's a machine that we don't know about that can move these numbers.
I don't feel that there's a machine behind Biden at this point. I mean, the establishment is behind Biden, but I don't really see a machine there. You know, and now you see a lot of corrupt Democrats breaking off and flirting with Bloomberg.
Okay.
And they want the money. Some of them have gotten the money already, over years, and they've seen his, pardon the expression, generosity. And they know you watch South Carolina, what's going to be happening there. You watch all these corrupt politicians that start like crawling over to Bloomberg, just because they just know that there's going to be a payoff for them.
Okay.
And I'm not saying that he's writing them checks today, but they know if they back him now, that means money in their pockets.
Okay. Let me talk to you about Willie Brown vis-a-vis Elizabeth Warren.
It's funny to bring that up when I'm talking about money in their pockets.
Yes. Yes. A couple of people have written to me. And again, I'm not arguing with you. I would never argue with you. But you are still not being critical of Elizabeth Warren. Harvey Kay is also not being too critical of Elizabeth Warren. A lot of my listeners have become disgusted by Elizabeth Warren. These are the Bernie supporters, and they don't understand how and why you're so forgiving of her. And it reminds me of my relationship with Willie Brown, who used to be the mayor of San Francisco, where I'm from, but he was also Speaker of the California Assembly. He was the
He was one of the most powerful Democrats in the whole country.
Yes.
When he was the speaker. When he was the mayor, it was already like, you know, it was already joke time. But
right.
before that, he was really, really a major American power.
Yes. Up until Jesse Jackson, no African American in American history had received as many votes. If you tallied up all the votes he had received, he was the most successful African-American politician in American history until Jesse Jackson came along. And I worked, you know, he would hire me to do fundraisers and events. And he, you know, I love him. And to me, it became the politics of the personal. You became emotionally invested in Willie Brown. It didn't matter.
That happens to me all the time.
Yeah, it doesn't matter what he stood for. You loved Willie Brown, right?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I didn't feel that way about Willie Brown, but I have felt that way about many politicians who were flawed people, but who I had a good personal relationship with. And I when I say I don't mean flawed people, but I mean flawed politically.
And he was a deeply flawed.
Oh, yes. But, you know, even with music, I've had that where someone, you know, like there's an old story. I don't know if I've told you this or not. I bet I haven't. But when I first met, you know, I had a radio show in San Francisco where the ad for my show was, it was something along the lines of the one place on the radio dial where you never have to worry about hearing Madonna. I mean, I was very anti-Madonna. Right. And then I became the general manager of Sire Records, her company.
Wow.
The first time I met her, it was in a very interesting, well, it wasn't the first time, but it was the second time I met her. And it was a very interesting situation where it was backstage at Madison Square Garden, and she was doing a benefit concert, and no one knew that it was a benefit concert, but and AIDS wasn't that well known. It was just sort of getting started as a big deal. And she was giving all the money, which was more than $1 million, all the money that she was getting for the night was going to an AIDS charity. And she didn't want anyone to know it. It was never publicized. It was never in the press. It was just something that she wanted to do, because she wanted to do it.
Right.
And I was really impressed with her. And suddenly, her music wasn't as horrible to me as I thought it was. And I started listening to it and giving it a chance.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the same thing with music of you know, other friends of mine. So, like, you know, I've always been friends with the Jefferson Airplane. They were like, you know, I took my first acid trip with some of those guys. And I've known them for a really long time. And even though some of the music I really couldn't take, there was always something. I mean, in the beginning, I liked their music. But in later day, when they had other bands and stuff like that, and solo projects, I would always, you know, really try to see what was good in the music. Right. And whenever it was, you know, I liked someone as a person, I always really, really gave an extra try to like their music. Whereas if I didn't know them and I heard their music and I didn't like it, was not as open-minded to listening to it like five times until I could find what was good about it. So it's the same thing I find in politics now. If I start to like someone as a person, then I try to find what's good about them and what they're doing that's good, and maybe I'm a little bit forgiving about the things that aren't as good.
And isn't that what makes Bernie so great? Because he doesn't ask.
Bernie is the greatest, absolutely. I mean, any of the people who write to you complaining about me, tell them that. Well, Bernie is number one, and is like and number two, and number three, and number four, and number five for me. I mean, it's Bernie.
And he doesn't ask you. He doesn't make it personal. He doesn't ask you to like him. He literally told somebody, can you shut that baby up? There was a baby crying, and he's, please, can you shut that baby up? And I thought, This is the greatest politician in American history. Shut that baby up.
But, you know, today I was seeing my doctor, and she said she heard Bernie speaking about himself for the first time. She doesn't follow politics that much. And she said she heard this speech where he talked about himself, and it convinced her that she should vote for him because she liked that she could understand who he was and where he's coming from. I mean, she already liked his policies, but she wasn't positive that he was the guy. But after hearing him talk about himself, that turned her around. And this is like one of the greatest cancer researchers in the whole United States, or in the whole world, in fact.
Right, right. Before you go, black support for Trump. Harvey Kay is on the show today. He was in Los Angeles meeting with Cenk Uygur. I want to ask you about Cenk Uygur and California 25 before you go. But Harvey Kay, Professor Harvey Kay, said he was talking with an African-American who said he liked Trump. And Harvey said he kept rubbing his eyes and go, what's going on here? And then I read you over at Down with Tyranny. Trump has support in the African-American community.
Hard to believe, and I don't know that I still don't know that I believe it, but three polls in a row came out showing him at about a third of the African-American vote, which would be up from between 6 and 8% of what he got in 2016. So that's quite amazing, if it's true. I still don't believe it.
33%. 33% possibly.
One poll showed 36 even. But the thing is this. You know, you can understand why a lot of white voters, white working class voters, didn't want to vote for Hillary, and they took a chance with Trump, and they were dissatisfied with the Democratic Party. Why not believe that African Americans feel the same way?
Yeah.
The Democratic Party, they've done something for African Americans, but there's still a lot that they haven't done. And there's still a lot there, a lot of inequality, and a lot of, economically and in terms of justice, there's a lot of problems with Democrats. Obviously, we know that Trump would make it even worse for them. And I think that's why, in the end, we're not going to see much more than that 6 to 8% that he got last time. But I can see why people are unhappy with the Democratic Party now. I can see why black people are, just the same way I can see why white people are.
Yeah, I mean,
Democratic Party sucks. As my grandfather always told me, the only thing that's worse than the Democratic Party is the Republican Party.
Yeah, but if you're African American, Trump has done some movement on criminal justice reform, right?
I guess. I mean, I don't think he even knows what he did.
Okay.
His son-in-law came along. They wanted to see his son-in-law and daughter want to be cool, so they got him to endorse something that Trump didn't even understand.
Okay. I don't want to try to predict why a black person would vote for Trump and why he would be rising with them, but it.
Yeah, I just don't believe it.
But those are votes for Bernie, is what you're basically saying. That 36%.
Of course, but let's see what happens on election day. I mean, he is not getting a third of the African American vote. They're just not going to happen.
Right.
I don't care what that poll says. I would like to know, exactly how they polled, who they polled, how they did it, and what the questions were. There's no way. I'll accept that Trump's doing better than 6%.
Okay.
But he ain't 36%.
Before you go, Cenk Uygur from the Young Turks, amazing guy. Took something out of nothing and created this amazing machine, the Young Turks. He is now, I guess, is it official? Is he running officially for Katie Hill's seat, California 25?
Absolutely. He and his wife are moving to that district. He's actually up there and he's running against a corporate Democrat, Christy Smith, I think is her name.
And you're endorsing Cenk, right?
No, not yet. I don't know that we will or we won't. It's not up to me. I have some partners also that I have to consult on this. But I wrote a very good post about him today.
He likes Bernie, right? Cenk is a Bernie supporter.
You bet he is. Yeah. Absolutely. He's officially endorsed Bernie about a month ago.
Right.
And he's, but more important, I mean, in some ways more important than that, his platform is incredible. I mean, when I try to get my partners to go along with endorsing a candidate, one of the things that we always talk about is, will they be in a position to, and will they have the ability to and the desire to make Congress better? Will they be, you know, do they have the courage, do they have the fortitude and the aptitude to really make Congress better than it is, the way AOC does, for example? And there's no question that Cenk will be the best. He'd be amazing. His platform is so incredible. I mean, the first thing he starts talking about is bribery. And he, like me, he considers campaign contributions from big corporations to be bribes. And he comes right out and says it. Now, the woman he's running against is someone who takes those bribes. And she has told other people that she finds it personally offensive for anyone to call corporate contributions bribes. So, you know, that's going to be an interesting race between them. But the thing that I was trying to get at was that I think that having Cenk in Congress would be absolutely amazing, like amazing. He has flaws, just like anybody else, absolutely has flaws. But if she goes to Congress, you'll never hear from her again.
Right.
She'll just be buried in the morass and never do anything. That's who she is. She was in the assembly and never heard anything about her, and nor would you ever expect to. She's just going to be someone who sits there and does whatever the leadership tells her to do.
Okay. And
Cenk, you hear about every single day.
Okay.
You'll always hear about him. He will be controversial. He will be pushing and pushing. He'll be making enemies. The right people. He'll be a star on Fox every single day. They'll be talking about him.
Right. Before you go, this is what I thought was really kind of shocking to read over at Down with Tyranny. You write about California 25, where Katie Hill used to be their congressman, and Cenk is hopefully going to be the new congressman from California 25. It is kind of northeast of Los Angeles. I always think of Palmdale and Lancaster, Santa Clarita and Valencia as ultra, ultra right wing.
Well, they're not. And Valencia's not in the district, I don't think.
But you write that the days of those type of districts in California being solid red are over. Almost, you say, forever?
Well, I mean, no one knows what's going to happen eventually. But what I said is that, you know, right now, a Republican isn't, and when I say right now, I mean in the next years, several years at least, and then after that, we don't know. But no Republican is going to win that district because it's a Democratic registration advantage. So in other words, for a Democrat to win, all they have to do is turn out their base. So a Democrat turns out the base and they win. And they have to get independent voters. They don't need one Republican vote. There are more Democrats, and this is relatively new development, but there are more Democrats in California 25 than there are Republicans. So that's how they win. They get turn their base out. And the independents, there's a big contingent of independents, they hate Trump right now. So I don't see any Republican winning that district, no matter what they do.
And Orange County, gone. Never again, for at least in the next 10 years.
I'm a little bit nervous because some of the Democrats that were elected, I mean, they're not all like Katie Porter. Katie Porter isn't great. She's safe because she's just what a congressperson should be. She is out front doing a lot of work, doing good work. She's, she's perfect for her district. Some of the other ones are just, you know, there's a couple who are very, very rich and who bought their seats, who are, you know, schlemiels who don't do anything, who are nothings. And, you know, why would a Democrat even go out and vote for someone like, you know, turn up to vote for someone like Gil Cisneros?
Right.
You know, there's no reason to. But they're going to come out and vote for against Trump, basically, this year. So I think everyone is safe this year. In 2022, that's when the Republicans can make some gains back in a place like Orange County, because you've got a schlemiel like Gil Cisneros in the 39th district. There's no reason for anyone to vote for him. He bought his seat. He spent, I don't know, $7, $8, $9, $10 million buying that seat.
This is the lottery winner, right?
He won the lottery, right. And he's done nothing since he got to Congress. He's just a nothing. There's nothing there. There's no reason for anyone to vote for him. None.
Okay.
So, but in 2020, it's not going to matter because people are there to vote against Trump. In 2022, they won't be there. They're not going to come out and vote. Democratic base will not come out and vote for a guy like Gil Cisneros. There's no reason to.
But the Democrats get to redistrict, assuming...
No, California has nonpartisan redistricting.
That's true. That's true. All right. Howie Klein, thank you. Great job as always. Howie Klein is the founder and treasurer of the Blue America PAC. They raise money for progressive and some socialist candidates. Did you give away the gold record yet?
No, no, we haven't done it. That's going to be next weekend.
Okay. And...
Pramila Jayapala.
Yes. And read him over Down with Tyranny. And I will see you personally next week.
Yes, I'm looking forward to it.
I'm paying, so I'm not.
Well, you're paying, but not at the Auburn. I'll see you next week.
Okay, thank you. Bye.
Bye.